This animation is intended to illustrate the steps required to perform a loop or mesh circuit analysis on a resistive DC network. We will be using loop analysis to calculate the resistor currents and voltages for all resistors in this simple circuit. There are six general steps required for performing loop analysis. The first step in the process is to identify and arbitrarily assign a direction to the loop currents in the circuit. Next, we mark the polarity of the elements in each loop in terms of our assumed current direction. In step 3 of the process, we create the Kvl equation for each loop in terms of the specified loop direction. We then move on to use Ohm's law to specify the unknown Kvl voltages in each loop equation in terms of current and resistance. Once we have acquired the Kvl voltage expressions for each loop in the circuit, we use substitution and elimination to solve for the unknown loop currents. The process is completed by using the loop currents to calculate resistor current and voltage throughout the circuit. We will begin the solution to our example problem by identifying and assigning a direction to the loop currents in the circuit. The first loop current, I1, flows through resistor R1, resistor R3, and voltage source E1. In this example, we have arbitrarily chosen a clockwise direction to represent the current flowing around loop 1 in the circuit. The second loop current, I2, flows through resistor R2, voltage source E2, and resistor R3. As with loop 1, we've assigned a clockwise current flow direction for loop 2. With the loop currents identified, we can now move on to step 2 of the process. For this part of the analysis, we mark the polarity of elements in each loop in terms of the assumed current directions that we've arbitrarily assigned. Starting with loop 1, we mark the known polarity of voltage source E1. We now assign polarity to the remaining elements in loop 1 according to the I1 current direction selected in step 1. For electron flow, current is said to enter the negative end of an element and exit through the positive end of the element. We start the loop 2 assignment with the known polarity of voltage source E2. We complete the second step of the process by assigning polarity to the remaining elements in loop 2 in terms of current I2. With the polarity determined in terms of the selected loop current directions, we are now ready to move on to the third step of the process. In this step of the process, we're ready to construct the Kirchhoff's voltage law equations for each loop in the circuit. Start in the upper left-hand corner of loop 1 and travel around the loop in a clockwise direction to create the Kvl equation. When you travel from the negative end of an element to the positive end of an element, the voltage is considered to be positive and is added when constructing the Kvl expression. Inversely, if you travel from the positive end of an element to the negative end of an element, the voltage is subtracted in the Kvl equation. When considering the voltage across resistor R1, we're moving from negative to positive. This means that this value is added or positive. For the voltage across resistor R3, we are once again moving from negative to positive, so this voltage is added as well. We complete our walk around the loop by considering the voltage on E1. This voltage also is added as we're moving from negative to positive. Kirchhoff's voltage law states that the algebraic sum of the voltages around any given loop must equal zero. We therefore set this new equation equal to zero. Next, we construct the Kvl equation for loop 2 in the same manner. Starting in the upper left corner of loop 2, we once again move in a clockwise direction around the loop. For VR2, we're moving from negative to positive, so the value is added or considered to be positive. When we come to the E2 voltage source, we're moving from positive to negative polarity. Therefore, the value of E2 is subtracted in the Kvl equation. For VR3, we're moving from negative to positive, so the value is added, and the entire equation is set to equal zero. We now have the Kvl equations for both loops and can move on to step 4 of the process. In this step, we will be using Ohm's law to re-express the voltage drops in each of the loop equations. Beginning with loop 1, the R1 voltage drop can be restated as the value of R1 times current I1. When expressing the voltage drop across R3 in this manner, it's important to note that the current for R3 is a combination of I1 and I2. We have expressed the I1 and I2 currents as moving in opposite directions. We are dealing with loop 1 here, so the voltage drop across R3 can be expressed as the value of R3 times the I1 current less the I2 current. This same R3 current value will be expressed as I2 minus I1 when we deal with loop 2. We now substitute the known resistance and source values into our modified Kvl equation for loop 1. Next, we expand the equation and then collect like terms to state the equation with unknowns on one side and a known voltage on the other. We repeat the process for loop 2 to obtain the Ohm's law representation of the loop 2 Kvl equation. Again, notice that as we're working with loop 2, the I1 current is being subtracted from the I2 reference current when we're considering the voltage drop across R3. As was done for equation 1, we substitute in our known values, expand the equation, collect like terms, and separate those terms with unknown quantities from those of constant value voltages. Now that we have two Kvl equations with two unknowns, I1 and I2, we move on to step 5 and solve for these unknown values. To solve for current I1, we eliminate the I2 terms from these equations. To do this, we find the lowest common multiple for the I2 coefficients. In this case, it is 45. Our objective is to create a common coefficient for I2 in both equations. To do this, we multiply each equation by whatever value is required to get the I2 coefficient to be 45. This is accomplished by multiplying the loop 1 equation by 5, and by multiplying the loop 2 equation by 3. Depending on the sign of the I2 coefficients, we either add or subtract these two new equations from each other to eliminate the I2 term and solve for I1. The coefficients for I2 do not have the same sign. We therefore add the equations, and it results in 0 I2. Once the I2 term has been eliminated, we proceed by solving for I1. Having determined the value of the I1 loop current, we can use substitution to obtain the I2 loop current. Using the loop 1 equation, we substitute in the value for I1 and proceed to calculate the value of I2. To confirm the validity of our calculation, we could also substitute the I1 value into the loop 2 equation, and we should end up at the exact same result. It is also important to note that instead of solving for I1 by eliminating I2 as we did at the start of step 5, we could just as easily have solved for I2 by eliminating I1. Having determined the value of I1 and I2, it is easy to calculate the value of IR3 and move on to the final step of the process. Because the loop 2 and loop 1 currents flowing through resistor R3 are flowing in opposite directions and the loop 2 current is larger, the net resulting current, I3, will flow in the same direction as loop current I2. With all three resistor currents known, it is a simple matter of applying Ohm's law to calculate the voltage drop across each resistor. The voltage drop across resistor R1 is equal to 1.091 volts. Resistor R2 is dropping 10.909 volts. And finally, we calculate the voltage drop across resistor R3 as being 13.091 volts.